Hello, everybody. Sorry I'm late. Those of you who are here. Sorry. We were having a family Led Zeppelin moment. Where are you? Hello, everybody. Having a little Led Zeppelin moment with the family. And you can see it on Facebook if you haven't seen it. So it's worth seeing, man. So anyway, hope you guys are having a great night. You know, I just, when I was out witnessing yesterday, one of the guys brought up to me, he pointed out about the top copy manuscript. Hello, Sarah. Hello, Phil. Hello, Emmanuel. I don't know if Emmanuel's here. Pro-life Chloe. Hey, my fellow Clubhouse. Hey, you're a rock star on Clubhouse. Praise God. You're there to help with the Arabic. That was awesome. Really great. That was really, what a blessing, man. So anyway, what happened is somebody yesterday when I was out witnessing, I don't know if you guys heard it, but I was at the mosque and it was dark and everything. But one guy actually brought up the subject of the top copy manuscript of the Quran. And so, oh, God bless you, Sarah. Thank you. Thank you for hanging out with us. So we're not going to do, because somebody brought it up, that's the first time somebody's actually brought up a Quran manuscript. That's really going deep, to talk about Quran manuscripts. And you guys, there are Quran manuscripts. There's several of them. There's the Birmingham manuscript. There's the Petropolitanus, which is in Paris. And then there's the Al-Husseini, which is in Egypt. There's the Tashkent, which I think that's in Azerbaijan. Azerbaijan? Yeah, I think that's where it is. And then there's the one in, there's the Sana manuscript, Petropolitanus, thank you. Then there's the Sana manuscript, which they found in Yemen. So there's all these different ones. And you know what? I'm actually considering doing an episode about each one of these in the next few days, just because somebody actually brought it up. Very intelligent to bring that up, to actually bring up a Quran manuscript. Just kind of as a spoiler alert here, there are no first generation Qurans. There is nothing complete, no whole Qurans at all, okay, from the first, from the 7th century. That's what you want. You want from the 7th century when Muhammad lived. If the Quran was complete by then, if Uthman had already, come up with his revisions to it and his changes, and he made his what he was going to do to the Quran, because he's the one who burned the previous one and made a new one. And so anyway, but when I was at the mosque yesterday, somebody actually mentions the one in Turkey. Well, the one in Turkey, you guys, is called the the top copy is what it's called. Top copy. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about that, just because that particular one is the closest that they have. Yes, they're or 8th century. They're either 9th or 8th century, but they're like within about 100 years after Muhammad. So they're not even in the same generation as Muhammad or Uthman, so they say these are the original Uthmanic Qurans. They're not. So it's good to know a little bit about each one of these. Specifically, there's six of them. There's six of them. Thank you, Surah. Would you like to come on? Would you like to come on, Surah 2 Project? Just because it seems like you know quite a bit about this. I'm very serious about that, too. I'd like you, if you do know quite a bit about it, I'd like for you to come on. And we can talk about it. I'm sending you an invitation if you'd like to come on. Yeah, thank you, Phil Hooray. This is about the burning where Uthman burned the Quran. And you know what? You guys, there's so many problems. There's so many problems in with the Quran and with the compilation of the Quran, you know, and the seven ahruf that they supposedly had. And, you know, what happened to the Saba Ahruf when Uthman burned? There's actually some hadith that say that Uthman burned six of them and kept one. There's actually some hadith that say that he burned six of them and kept one of the Saba. Now, if they, Muhammad said that these are all the Quran, you know, these are inspired by Jibreel, you know, inspired by Allah and brought by Jibreel and all that, how can you burn them? How can you burn them? Why don't you leave them so people could research them or something? Nope, they burned them, you know. That's not what Christians do. That's not what Christians do. What Christians do, if we have a manuscript and there is some variance between one manuscript and another, what we'll do, as we do, is we write it in a footnote. We say, okay, here's a footnote. And this footnote says that this particular verse is not in all of the ancient manuscripts. For instance, there's some question about the location of John chapter 8, verses 1. You know, the story of the, if thou let he that is without sin cast the first stone. There's some questions about the last verses of Mark chapter 16. You know, but we tell you, in the Bible we tell you, there's some many ancient manuscripts that don't have this, okay? Or there's some variance here. Or, you know, here's another one about Saba Ahruf. Thank you, Phil. Phil is the rock star, man. So, okay. Thank you, Suda. Okay, thank you for doing that. Suda's going to help us by sending some information as we go along. So, there's so many problems. We can't even begin to touch, you know, I know that God Logic is doing some really great work about the Uthman problem and the about some of these issues, you know. But you guys, this is when they actually bring it up. I haven't had somebody actually do this before. But you know what this tells me, you guys, is that they're being taught about this. They're being taught about these wonderful manuscripts. One's in Turkey, one's in Egypt, one's in Paris, one's in London, and one, you know, about all of these manuscripts. The great Birmingham manuscript that's only got, what, a few verses on it, or the Sana manuscript. And the amount of problems with each one of these is, you know, there's so many problems. And there was the added problem with the particular, there's some of them, for instance, the Petropolitanus, the one that's in Paris. You can study that one because it's in a Christian country. And then there's the one in the Birmingham manuscript. You can study that because it's in a Christian manuscript. I just want to put this up. Carol has said, maybe we can talk about the Sana manuscript one of these days, since it is only a complete, the only complete manuscript which has erasures and blot. Thank you, Carolyn. You know, I mentioned the Sana manuscript which in Yemen, which is, you know, again, it's one of the only complete manuscript, but there's so many erasures and blots, you know, and you'll have a word written and underneath it there's another word, you know, and so there's so many problems with the Sana manuscript as well. Yes, we will do that. You know what? This is just kind of came up because of what happened last night. Because last night, like I said, I was at the mosque. I'll get the clip so you guys can see it, where a guy actually brought up, hey, we have the complete Quran in Turkey, you know. Okay, but like I was telling you, the one in Paris, we could study that one because it's in a Christian country. The one in London, we can study because it's in a Christian country. But the ones that are in the Muslim countries, those are almost impossible to get to, especially if you're a Christian, to study them. And so, welcome, Emmanuel. Be nice to Pinky today, okay, Emmanuel? You know, I mean, I'm not trying to make problems from the very beginning, okay? I'm not trying to make problems, okay? But try to be nice today, you know? I think you got issues, my friend. I think you got issues. There's a problem with Pinky that you have. I think you got to deal with some stuff, man. But, you know, I don't want to embarrass you in front of everybody. So, but anyway, because the ones are in Paris, the ones in London, the ones in the Christian countries, you can study those. But the ones in the Muslim countries, almost impossible, especially if you're a Christian. For a Christian to go to a Muslim country and study one of these manuscripts that they have. But the good thing is, and I know some of you guys saw the video on El Fadi's channel, where Jay Smith spoke about this, where Jay Smith spoke about these different manuscripts. And the good thing is, two Muslim doctors went and studied the top copy manuscript in Turkey. And the stuff that I'm going to share with you is what they said. It's not what some Christian said. It's not what some ex-Muslim said. These are Muslim doctors, Muslim researchers. This is what they said about the top copy. Now, this is the top one. This is the one that they all, oh, this is the Uthmani. This is what Uthman, you know. And like I said, I was at the mosque, and they're the ones that brought this up. They brought this up, that this is the great Quran. Okay. And so anyway, so I wanted to study it a little bit, and I thought, dude, this is really interesting. And I really wanted to share some of the stuff with you that I learned today. A lot of it, you know, is not new information. You know, it's been out there, but still it's very beneficial to hear it again, you know? So let me just go ahead. I'm going to go ahead and give me a second here, because I want to free up some space here. I got so many slides here, it's hard to put all the information I have on here. But let me just go ahead and just take me a second here, you guys, to get all of this information here. So, okay. Okay, let me go ahead and do this. Just take me a second here to get some of this stuff together. Okay. It's not going to be a long live stream today, but you guys, if you get some of this information is really good. In case, I mean, I was really surprised that somebody actually brought this up yesterday. They brought it up at the mosque, and that means they must be teaching them this as a, look how great the Quran is. We got the 100% pure Quran and everything. And so this right here is the top copy. A picture like of the top copy manuscript. One of the things that you can learn about the top copy manuscript, this is the one that's in Turkey. You see that in the middle there? You kind of see that rectangle? See that rectangle in the middle? And it looks like it's got decorations, little red dots on it, red spots on it. Well, that's one of the ways that you can distinguish this, that it is the top copy manuscript. Because they put this in like every 100 verses or something. So this tells you that this is the top copy manuscript, okay? And, you know, let me just make this bigger here. One thing you'll notice about this is the no diacritical marks, okay? Which is, we can talk more about that. About the fact that there's no diacritical marks. A very big problem. And that is what has led to the confusion. That is what has led to the confusion that today is the attempt to resolve by calling it qira'at, recitations, different recitations of the Quran. But that's because of the fact that there's no diacritical marks in this. So let's look at a couple things about the top copy manuscript. Okay, here's one thing. Okay, this is okay. According to the evaluation of Munajjid, neither this mushaf nor the mushafs located Now, this is talking about the top copy. When I say Mus'haf, Mus'haf is another way of saying the Quran, the book, the physical book, the Quran. They call it a Mus'haf. Mus'haf. And so I'm saying neither this Mus'haf nor the Mus'hafs located in Tashkent, Al-Mashahid, Al-Hussein in Cairo, and in the Museum of Turkish and Islamic Works in in Istanbul, were none of these were the Mus'hafs attributed to the Caliph Uthman. None of those ones, not the ones in Turkey, not the ones in Paris, not the ones in London, not the ones in Egypt, not the one in Tashkent, none of these, I think it's Uzbekistan actually, none of these are the Uthmani Qurans, you know, because you know what happened in, you know, what happened is that Uthman burned Qurans, came up with his new Quran, and when he came up with his new one, standard version Quran, when he came up with his own, he sent them to four capitals or six capitals, Muslim capitals, to where these were sent out as the standard Qurans that people need to copy. Okay, so these are so they believe that there's six of these out there. Okay, but none of these, and see this what this, according to the evaluation, none of the ones that are in Cairo, Turkey, Paris, London, wherever, are the Uthmani Qurans. None of them are the Uthmani Qurans. Okay, however, considering the differences in their script, the centuries when they were copied, and their different dimensions, they must have been copied from the Mus'hafs attributed to Caliph Uthman. For this reason, they are called Uthmani Qurans, but they are not the Uthmani Qurans. Okay? Now, this is Ali Al-Tikulak, and this is one of the two guys. There was two guys who were allowed. There were two guys who were allowed to go study the top copy manuscript because they're Muslims. So they were allowed to go study the top copy manuscript. And this is one of them, okay? And he said, sorry, guys, sorry. This top copy manuscript is not one of the Uthmani Qurans. It is not one of the Uthmani Qurans. Okay. And also, if you study it, they say that this has like 99% of the Quran, but it's got like 23 missing verses. 23 missing verses. And I'm searching. I want to find out. Maybe some of you know what those 23 verses are. I would like to find out what those 23 missing verses are. Okay, if anybody knows about them, please put it here. Let me see. Actual spelling. Let me see. I want to see. Why are the early coins have Christian symbols? Is it because Islam didn't exist? Yes, it is. And you know what an interesting thing is, villainous, is not only that, but they actually have coins with the word Muhammad in Arabic, Muhammad written in Arabic with a cross on top of it. And you know what that tells you is you see that Muhammad isn't really a name. Muhammad means the praised one, so that it really isn't a name. It's a title, the praised one. The praised one is the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not Muhammad. It is the Lord Jesus Christ. Because they had the name Muhammad, and on top of it, they had a cross on some of the coins. You know, that's another subject, you know. And I'm again, you guys, I wasn't going to do this except that when I was at the mosque yesterday, a kid brought this up. It wasn't a kid. It was a young, to me, he's a kid, but he's probably about 30 or 40. But he brought this up. He's the one that brought this up. So I wanted to go and look at some of the issues regarding each of these different manuscripts Today, I'm just looking at the top copy. This is the one in Turkey. It's the most highly regarded because it's the closest one to a complete Quran. None of them are complete. None of them are complete. None of them are complete. Okay, but they all got bits and pieces, especially the Birmingham. But anyway, so, you know, that's why I'm doing this. I'm just wanted to talk a little bit. And I really appreciate, yes, Jesus is the praised one. Amen. Muhammad. Villainous. Yes. Dude, you know what? That's going to be my next big sign. Muhammad was a Christian. Yeah. Thank you for putting that. That's exactly. For over a month, I've been thinking, I want to have a big sign that says Muhammad was a Christian. They don't know Muhammad is the Muhammad, the praised one. I want to see, you know, like they say Jesus was a Muslim. I want to say Muhammad is a Christian. And then when they come up and argue with me, I'm going to try that. If I get killed because of it, remember who put that up there. Just kidding. I've really been thinking about doing it. But then when I saw Villainous actually write that, I'm going to do it, you guys. I'm going to have a sign that says that in Jesus' name. So, of course, what we know about Muhammad, he was no Christian. But his beliefs were very Christian, I think. Some of them. He believed that Jesus died on the cross. He believed Jesus was equal to God. That's what it says in the Quran. So, anyway. All right, let's just continue. I'm going to show you some stuff from... let me show you some stuff here. From, okay. Okay, conclusions of Muslim scholars. Okay. First of all, let me go. Okay, these are some of the brave confession. From these are the two guys. These are the two guys who the Muslim guys who were allowed to study the top copy manuscript. This is what he said. We have none of Uthman's mushafs. As a brave confession, they have none of Uthman's mushafs. So they tell you, oh, we got Uthman's Quran over in Turkey. This guy who studied it says, we have none of Uthman's mushafs. They don't have any of the six that he sent around. He says, we don't have any of them. Okay? This is a Muslim scholar, you guys. This is one of the two guys. His name is Ekmeleddin. Ihsanoglu. Ekmeleddin Ihsanoglu. I know I'm massacring his name. But he's one of the two who were Muslim researchers who were allowed to study the top copy manuscript. And this is what he said. We have none of Uthman's mushafs. Don't be deceived. They don't have any of them. They do not have an Uthmani manuscript. Okay. Another thing this guy says, nor do we have any copies from those manuscripts. He said, not only do we not have the originals, we don't even have the copies. We don't even have the copies of the Uthmani manuscripts. Dude, that's a huge confession. Saying, you know, when they said that, you know, like I said, by the mosque, the guy tells me, we have the original Quran, it's over in Turkey. Nope, you don't have any of Uthman's, and the Uthmani ones aren't really the original Quran. The Uthmani ones aren't the original Quran. They're Uthman's reclench, whatever they call it, you know, reclension or something like that, recession. I can't remember the word. But they're Uthman's version, which was changed from whatever Hafsa had, which was collected by Zayd ibn Thabit. And there were so many problems with the original, the very first compilation, which Abu Bakr did. And then he gave it to Hafsa. It ended up with under Hafsa's bed for 20 years. You guys, how does the whole religion depends on this book? How does it stay under somebody's bed for 20 years? How does the religion continue when you got the only copy of it in the universe is under somebody's bed, under the prophet's wife's bed? How does that happen? Anyway, this we know the problems that happened between Syria and Azerbaijan. There were problems. And then Uthman was asked, hey, dude, you got to help us here. We're going to turn into Christians and Jews. We're going to be like the Christians and the Jews, you know, with a corrupted book. And so he said, okay, bring me all your copies. He burned them and came up with his own. He brought Zayd ibn Thabit, said, hey, come on, Zayd, we need another Quran. And so he put another Quran. He brought some Quraishi people or three other guys. And they said, okay, guys, put a Quran together for us. And it says, if you have any disagreement about anything, just change it into the Quraishi dialect. Meaning he was telling them, if you have any problems or doubts, just make it into the Quraishi. He's saying, make something up, but make sure it's in the Quraishi dialect. That's what Uthman said, you guys. And so, but anyway, these guys who actually went and studied the Quran that is in Turkey, top copy, they said, listen, conclusion number one, we don't have any Uthmani mushafs. We don't have them. They're not in Yemen. They're not in Turkey. They're not in Uzbekistan. They're not in Paris. They're not in London. They're nowhere. They don't exist. We do not have. This is the Muslim researcher who was allowed to study the top copy manuscript in Turkey. This is one of those two researchers. He says, we do not have any Uthmani mushafs. Number two, nor do we have any copies of those mushafs. I mean, not only do we not have the original, we don't even have the copies. Okay, then he says, these mushafs, meaning the top copy and others, are from the later Umayyad period. The later Umayyad period. Okay, so you know, the bam, Uthman burning the Quran is like a bonfire. You know what? You know what that tells you, you know, Rob? If he burned them, what that tells you is the reason he burned them is because they were different, because they were full of variances. And Allah did not do what he said he was going to do in chapter 15, verse 9, نَحْنُ نَزَلْنَا ذِكْرُ نَحْنُ لَهُ لِحَافِظُونَ, that we sent down the reminder and we preserved it. He did not preserve it. And so with all the problems, you know, I want to do a history, a little history lesson about all the problems that happened from the time Muhammad allegedly started getting the Quran until Uthman came up with his. And then after, I know, I mean, this is huge historical research just based on what I know. This is so devastating. It's so devastating to the beliefs. And I remember when I was a Muslim, I believe the gospel has been changed, the Torah has been changed, but nobody can change the Quran. No way. You know, the way they say it in Arabic is that it goes in with the mother's milk. It goes in with the mother's milk, meaning that from the time you're a baby, you are marinated in this belief. You are indoctrinated that the Quran is perfectly preserved, every dot, every letter. It's so much a part of what you are and who you are to believe that. And then when you start hearing these crazy stories, even the crazy stories from the lifetime of Muhammad, when there was two incidents, one with Omar bin Khattab, one with Ubay bin Ka'b, where, you know, they heard somebody reciting a verse different. They take him to Muhammad and then they say, hey, he's reciting the Quran wrongly. Ubay bin Ka'b is the real hero in this one. He goes to Muhammad. One guy, he says, listen to how he recites this verse. And the guy recites it. And then Muhammad says to Ubay, okay, you recite it. And then Ubay says it. And they were obviously different. And then Muhammad says, you are both right. And you know what Ubay bin Ka'b says? He says, it's impossible that we're both right. It's impossible that we're both right. From then, Ubay bin Ka'b knew something stinks. Something stinks. It's impossible that we're both right. Because we're different. The things we're saying are different. It's impossible that we're both right. Ubay bin Ka'b said that. And he says, دَخَلْ فِي نَفْسِي شَكْ. Doubt entered my heart. Ubay ibn Ka'b said this, doubt entered my heart. This is in the time of Muhammad, when Muhammad was alive. But Muhammad knew how to solve doubt. Muhammad was very gifted in taking care of people's doubts. He hit Ubay ibn Ka'b. Physical violence. That's how you take care of doubt. That's how Muhammad gets rid of doubt. Physical violence. He struck him in the chest so hard. He hit him so hard that sweat popped out of his forehead. He said, sweat jumped off my skin when he hit him so hard that sweat jumped out. He hit him so hard. See, Muhammad knows how to get rid of your doubts. He threatens you with physical violence. And he hit him physically. And it hurt his chest. Just like when he hit Aisha. When he hit Aisha in the chest. And she said, oh, Ja'atini, it hurt me. In the same way, he hit Ubay ibn Ka'b in the chest. And it hurt him. And sweat came off. It was such a strong hit. But, you know, I kind of wonder if that when he hit him, you know, some people say, like if you listen to Yasser Qadhi, that was the magical touch of the Prophet that removes doubt. I think it was Ubay ibn Ka'b understood, if you don't shut up, if you don't shut up, I'm going to cut your head off. I think Ubay ibn Ka'b knew Muhammad enough to know, I don't want problems with this guy. Same way Abu Bakr didn't want problems with him. He says, or this guy will get my head cut off. So, you know, so anyway, but that was the beginning. I mean, this is in the lifetime of Muhammad. And this happened again with Umar bin Khattab. Okay, so the problems are so, they go back to the time of Muhammad, and it's so amazing that, but anyway, so the fact, and what's funny about that though, you guys, is that the same problems that they had back in the time of Muhammad is the same problems they have now. Right now, they have the exact same problems that they had in the time of Muhammad, which is they got different versions of the Quran. They have so many different Qurans, but they're being told there's only one. They're being told there's only one, but they know there's all these 37. And so they got to come up with new words to explain it. They said, oh, this isn't the Quran, this is the Mus'haf. That's what my cousin used to say. He says, this isn't the Quran, this is a Mus'haf. Okay? And then he says, no, this isn't the Quran, this is a Qira'ah. And then, no, this isn't the Quran, this is a Ahruf, Harf. You know, this is a mode, this is a recitation, this is a book, you know, but it's not a Quran. And then you ask, well, which one is the Quran? All of them are the Quran. And then, which one is on the Lawh al-Mahfuz? All of them are. you know, if you watch last night, there was like about four minute or five minute time when I was talking to a guy, and he came up with all of these excuses. And poor guy, I feel sorry for him, because you're told there's only one Quran. You see in front of you that there's 150, and then and they're all different from each other. And then you got to tell yourself, but no, there's only one. And so you got to, how do you do this? You know, and you end up with cognitive dissonance is what you got. You got cognitive dissonance because you're holding two opposing beliefs at the same time. You have two opposing beliefs at the same time. I don't know what the effect of cognitive dissonance is, the long-term effect of cognitive dissonance is, but this is what you got. First of all, you got all these different Qurans, you know about them, and then you believe there's only one Quran. And how do you square that circle, you know? And you get cognitive dissonance. And I don't know what the long-term effects of cognitive dissonance is, you know, but I don't think it's good. Hopefully, it's salvation. Hopefully, it's salvation that you just say, you know what? This is ridiculous. I quit. I'm coming to the living word who is Jesus Christ, okay? So anyway, I'm just going to look and see if there's anything. Dissonance is when there is an interference between two things. Cognitive is knowledge. Thank you. You know, Emmanuel, my friend, deal with your heart, my friend. Deal with your heart because there's obvious issues there in your heart, my friend. Guarded tablet. Okay, thank you. That's the preserved tablet or the guarded tablet. In Arabic, the Lawh al-Mahfuz, okay? So anyway, so I was talking to this guy. So anyway, let's look at some more things that these guys said, okay? First of all, let me just read these two again because I heard these before, but today they really hit me between the eyes. The The top copy manuscript is in a Muslim country. It's in Turkey, in a museum in Turkey. Not anybody can get to them, or palace in Turkey, the top copy palace in Turkey. And so not anybody could get to them. And for a Christian, it's very difficult. If you look on the internet, there is a guy who he's called the digital archaeologist or something like that. And he tried to get to go see the top copy so he could take pictures of it. And I didn't read the whole thing, but I'm going to go back and read it. But it's very difficult for a Christian to go see these books. But two Muslims went and saw it. And those Muslims, what they said, these are some of their findings. We have none of Uthman's mushafs. We don't have Uthman's mushafs. We have something, but it ain't his. Don't call these Uthmani Quran. They're not. Number two, nor do we have any copies from those manuscripts. We don't even have copies of the Uthmani mushafs. Number three, these mushafs are from a later Umayyad period. Okay, the Umayyad period, you guys, was when it says later, it's between 661. Muhammad died 632, Uthman allegedly put the Quran together in 652. So this was like 10 years after Uthman, but this says it's from the later Umayyad period. It says the ones that you have now are from the later Umayyad period, and that would be around 750. Okay, more than 120 years after Muhammad died, that these Qurans were that like what you have at the top copy. So anyway, this is what the Muslims are saying. It's not what Christians are saying. Okay, let's look at it. Okay, this is the same thing. Okay, let's look at some of this right here. The top copy, mid 8th century. That means around 750, like I told you. It's from the mid, you know, like 100 years after Muhammad. Surah 1438. Okay, these are some of the differences between the top copy Quran and the Quran that they have now, the Hafs Quran. Okay. For instance, in Surah 1438, it says, "You know what we have, what we conceal, and what He revealed." And the other one is, "You know what we conceal and what we reveal." Okay, and the word, you guys, the difference in Arabic, the difference between these, you guys, is usually just a dot. It's just a dot or two dots. It's usually a dot or two dots, and you know, I could probably go and get it for you right now and show you. But I've done many episodes where I've showed you how that the diacritical marks, it could be one dot, changes the meaning, and it changes the subject of a sentence. Because many times, for instance, if you don't know Arabic, I'm afraid I'm wasting my time telling you this, but I could show it to you. But anyway, here's another difference between the top copy, what's in top copy, because there's... I'll show you this next. If you should die or be slain, you shall not be gathered. Whereas the Hafs that they have now says, if you should die or be slain before him, you shall undoubtedly be gathered. Okay. So in one, you shall be gathered. In the other, you shall not be gathered. Okay, this is Quran 3158. Big difference. Big difference, okay? But listen to this, guys. Listen to this. There are deviations from grammatic rules and spelling mistakes in the Mus'hafs attributed to Caliph Uthman. This is Al-Tikulak. This is the other guy who was, there were two guys who were allowed to study the top copy manuscript. The first one is this guy, Dr. Ekmeleddin Ehsanoglu. Okay, this is one of the guys. The other guy is this guy, Tayyar al-Tikaluk. I know I'm massacring his name. These are the two Muslim researchers who are allowed to study the Topkapi manuscript. Christians were not allowed to, but these guys were. And this is what they said. There are deviations from grammatical rules, like Kul hu Allahu Ahad. Okay, that's Surah 112. And spelling mistakes in the Mus'hafs attributed to Caliph Uthman. Now, this is the Muslim guys. He concludes 2,270 instances where there is a difference from the consonantal skeleton of the Fahd Mus'haf. The Fahd Mus'haf, you guys, is the Hafs Quran. The Fahd Mus'haf is the Hafs Quran. There are 2,270 differences between the Topkapi Quran and the Hafs Quran. So the next time they come to you, we have the original Quran in Turkey, and it's perfectly like, no, there's 2,270 differences between what's in Topkapi Palace in Turkey and what is in the Hafs Quran. This is according to these guys, man. It's according to this Tayyar al Tikulak, a Turkish researcher. 2,270 differences between what's in Turkey, Topkapi, and Hafs. It's called Fahd here, but Fahd is a reference to the Hafs. It's 2,270 differences, you guys. You know, okay, Michael Stein makes a very good point here, and we got to take that into consideration. Okay, you know, he says, Allah did not have spell check back then. So, thank you, okay? Thank you for clarifying that for us. So, 2,270 differences. Dude, you guys, this is great. Information, you guys. This is awesome information. And you know what? I wouldn't have even looked for it. But like I said last night when I was talking to those guys, I had like 10 guys around me last night from that mosque. And one of them said, the real Quran, we have it. It's in Turkey. Well, according to people who saw that Quran, who researched that Quran, who are Muslims, there's 2,270 differences between Topkapi Quran and Hafs Quran. Dude, that's pretty huge. That's pretty huge, you guys. So awesome. Awesome information. A lot of this I owe to Jay Smith. Thank you so much, Brother Jay Smith. Such a blessing. So anyway, guys, just a little bit of information that you can use there. If somebody ever tells you that we have the original Quran, the Topkapi, and they don't know the name of it as Topkapi. I told the guy last night. I said to him, you know the name of it? It's called the Topkapi Quran, okay? And it's incomplete. And it has 23 missing verses. So it's not the whole Quran. So I want to find out. If anybody knows, I'd like to know what those 23 missing verses are. It'd be funny if it's, I better be nice. Okay, it'd be fun. No, okay. So the Hafs Quran, good question. From what manuscript did the Hafs Quran come from? You know, I don't think it's from any of these, to be honest, but I better shut up just because I don't know. Okay, I don't know. Need to research that some more. Hafs was a student. Hafs and there was somebody else. I think both Hafs and Wash were both students of Asim. Asim was like one of the Hafaz, and then his students were Warsh and Hafs. And so they are the ones who took it from Asim. Okay, from Iraq. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Surah 2 Project. Surah 2, I think you are, you are very knowledgeable. Could really Kufa, that's the name of the script, Kufa script. Yes. Dude, this Suda 2 project. I'd be surprised if this is a, I wonder, wouldn't it be great? Wouldn't it be great if this is Jay Smith? anyway, thank you for that information. Wish you'd come on. So Demian Kuzmik says, perfectly preserved, 2270 different. This is just between in the top copy, you guys. And this is the top. This is the number one. The number one of the alleged six, because all of them are incomplete. All of them are incomplete, except this is the closest, even though it is incomplete too. But it supposedly has 99% of the Quran in it. And so, anyway, you know, I'm not sure. But, and, you know, when you're dealing with Hafs, you know, a whole nother subject about Hafs, and I've talked about it, and I've done programs about it. Let me see if I can pull this up for you just real quickly here without taking too long. But the whole issue with Hafs, and I've talked to sheikhs about this. I've talked to many sheikhs about this. You know what? In fact, this is what I'm going to do the next time I go to that mosque. I'm going to take this information. Even though some of them have started watching my live stream, so now they're going to be ready for me when I come there. Okay, but I just want to show you this. Okay. Let me just show you some of this. I know you guys, some of you already know this, but let me just show you, because our brother here, or sister, just pointed out the fact that Hafs was known as a liar and a thief. They said that Hafs was a liar and a thief, and very, very weak. a liar, a thief, and very, very weak when it comes to hadith. So if he was weak when it comes to hadith, how do you trust him with the Quran? You know, I was talking to an imam once, and I told this imam, I said, dude, it's like having a babysitter who molests your 12-year-old daughter. You have this babysitter come and molest your 12-year-old daughter, and then you say, okay, I also have a 6-year-old daughter. Would you come and babysit her next week? Would you do that? When you have someone who is untrustworthy with a 12-year-old, you're going to trust him with a 6-year-old? Obviously not. And so if you don't trust him with your hadith, and everybody says your hadith, he's unfaithful with it, he's a liar, he's a thief with the hadith, how can you trust him with the Quran? And that's what they're doing. So anyway, here's some quotes about Hafs, okay, from his father, that Hafs is one whose hadith are abandoned. Abandoned means untrusted. They're abandoned because nobody trusts him. Uthman al-Darami said, others said, Ibn Mu'ayn, that the Hafs is not to be trusted. Ibn al-Madani said, Hafs hadiths are weak and I have abandoned them on purpose. Okay, here's another thing. Let me just get this out of the way here. Yeah, he borrowed book. Okay, Abu Omar said, Hafs bin Sulaiman Qari, Quran reader from Kufa, his hadiths are to be abandoned. That means they're not to be trusted. And Oman Abu Hafs followed him, who is also known as Ibn Hafs. He is like him in weakness or weaker. This is in a Tabarani in Khabir, okay? Khawl al-Haythami, untrustworthy men. They are trustworthy men. But he, Hafs, was cavalier. Cavalier, you know what that means, you guys? He's kind of careless, just kind of careless. Cavalier, what a terrible word. What a terrible word to use to describe someone who almost 2 billion people on the planet trust their eternal souls to this man, Hafs. And he was cavalier, careless. Cavalier means like careless, like very carefree about the Quran. Okay, he was cavalier in the matter, so he should not be looked at, meaning acknowledged. So this is what it says about Hafs, you guys, and this is the guy that they're trusting with their eternal souls. Father, this is the one that Muslims trust their eternal souls to. Okay, Al-Nisa'i said, Hafs is not to be trusted and his hadiths are not to be written. And in another place that Hafs is one whose hadiths are to be abandoned. Salih bin Muhammad said, Hafs' hadiths are not to be written and his hadiths are false. Dude, said Abu Zar'a said, Hafs' hadiths are weak. And you trust him with the Quran? Al-Sagi from Ahmad ibn Muhammad al-Baghdadi, that Ibn Mu'in said, Hafs and Abu Bakr were the most knowledgeable of the Qira'at of Asim. And Hafs was more competent than Abu Bakr. He was a liar. Abu Bakr was truthful. Oh, dude, what do you do with this? What do you do with this? So, anyway. Okay, here's another resource by our brother Phil. Thank you, Phil. You guys, thank you so much for helping out. Basically, cavaliers are flirtatious, not true to one woman in France. The word comes from that. Thank you. Wow. He fabricated hadith in order to get money, and he also borrowed books, and then he didn't return them. He was a thief, too. They said he was a thief. And he would copy the books, okay? He would copy the books. He was a plagiarist, too. And this is the guy whose Quran now 90% of the Muslims in the world trust. His console. The best hadith. The Quran is called the best hadith. All right, you guys. Well, I just wanted to show you a couple of these things here about, because like I said yesterday, the top copy manuscript came up yesterday. Tomorrow, I think I'm going to do something about the Sana manuscript. Maybe the Sana manuscript, or I may do the Birmingham manuscript. Because I tell you what, I'm learning a lot from this. This is awesome material, you guys. And you know what? They're using it. Apparently they're teaching them this in the mosque. So we need to be prepared to show them the truth. Okay. So anyway, so that you will be armed and ready. So anyway, let me see. I'm gonna, you guys, I shouldn't do this. It's probably evil for me to do this, but I was with my family today and we sang a Led Zeppelin song. And so I'm going to play that Led Zeppelin song for you as we close up shop here. Let me see if I could show you this. Okay. 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 It's probably not a good idea to play a Led Zeppelin song on a live stream about the Bible. Where you're preaching the gospel. Let me see if I can get this. I may not be able to get it because I think I may have put it in the story, but not in the, you know what? I don't think I put it in the, so I won't be able to show you from that. So, all right, that's cool. We'll go ahead and go with the, where am I? Okay, here I am. Okay, that's me and my bride, by the way. So let me just go ahead and do a song for you before we go. I can play that song for you that I was going to do then. Dedicate it to my wife, okay?
The sun refused to shine, I would still be loving you. And when mountains crumble to the sea, there would still be you and me. Kind woman, I give you my all. Kind woman, nothing wrong. Little drops of rain, whispers of the pain, tears of love dropped on the days gone by. My, my, my. My love is strong. With you, there's nothing wrong. Together, we'll go until we die. Inspiration's what you are to me. Inspiration, look and see.
And so today, my world smiles. Your hand in mine, we walk the miles. Thanks to you, it will be done. 'Cause you to me are the only one. Happiness, no more be sad. Happiness, I'm glad. Alright, you guys, thanks for hanging out. And if you haven't done it, do it now. Jesus, help me. Jesus, forgive me. Jesus, come into my heart. Jesus, help me. Jesus, forgive me. Jesus, come into my heart. Yesor sa'idni. Yesor samihni. Yesor udkhul albi. Yesor sa'idni. Yesor samihni. Yesor udkhul albi. He loves you. I love you. Thank you guys for hanging out with us. And don't forget, you guys,
that the standard narrative has holes in it. That's what I'm going to say.
What happened there?
That the standard narrative has holes in it. That's what I'm going to say. Mm-hmm.